ألقى وأضاء للدنيا طريقا مشرقا وهدى من الرحمن يهدينا به للصالحات وللمكارم والتقى هذا كتاب الله أعذب منهل أنعم به من مورد لمن استقى قد صانه رب العباد بحفظه وحماه حتى لا يضيع ويخلقا طوبى لمن حفظ الكتاب بصدره فبدا وضيئا كالنجوم تألقا وتمثل القرآن في أخلاقه وفعاله فيه الفؤاد تعلقا وتلاه في جنح الدجى متدبرا والدمع من بين الجفون ترقرقا هذه صفات الحافظين كتابه حقا فكن بصفاتهم متخلقا.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على سيدنا وحبيبنا وشفيعنا وقرة أعيننا محمد رسول رب العالمين وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين وأصحابه الغر الميامين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، اللهم اجعلنا منهم يا أرحم الراحمين. We continue by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's blessings. Our khatira on the Quranic sciences. To be more precise, we are still talking about the history of the Quran. How this glorious Quran reached us in the same and in the exact way that our beloved sallallahu alaihi wasallam received it, and what are the stages that this Quran went through. We stopped at the stage of compiling the Quran in the time of Sayyidina Uthman radiallahu anhu, the third caliph, and we said that he requested after the incident that happened in Armenia and Azerbaijan and those countries when different reciters or Muslims from different countries they met and they were surprised how everyone is reading with a different reading from the one that he learned, and that how that thing was about to cause a big fitna and takfir to some extent among the Muslims, and how Sayyidina Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman radiallahu anhu, the keeper of the secret of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he ran to Al-Madinah and he told Sayyidina Uthman radiallahu anhu, you should do something before Muslims disagree on the Quran, just like the Christians and Jews did. So he radiallahu anhu requested the suhuf, as-suhuf al-bakriya if you like, or as-suhuf al-siddiqiya that was with Sayyidina, that was combined in the time of Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, then moved to Sayyidina Umar, then remained in the house and under the custody of Sayyidina Hafsa bint Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhum ajma'een, the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, our mother Sayyidina Hafsa. He requested those copies from her, asked her, please give us those copy or that copy of the Quran so that we make some copies and we send it to the main Muslim cities around the world at that time so that they will be the reference for Muslims if they disagree. And of course the main reliance in the transmission of the Quran is the oral transmission and the Qurra, but when people want to make copies they must have a reference, and also that oral transmission must be in complete agreement with the copy that was written in the presence of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So we have two guarantees, we have the written copy and we have the oral transmission. So they got those copies and he made a committee of four people. Who will be the main man for this task, you think? The same man who was in the time of Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, who did the greatest task, Sayyidina Zayd bin Thabit radiallahu anhu. That great young man who took the great and the very huge responsibility to copy the Quran in the time of Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. And remember his words when he said, "By Allah, if they told me to move a mountain from its place, it would have been easier for me to make that big job." And he did it radiallahu anhu with the help of all of the Sahaba, and they all agreed to those copy or to that copy that was collected in Sayyidina Abu Bakr's time. And now they needed that copy. Now Sayyidina Zayd is the main man in this committee. Sayyidina Zayd, remember, he used to write the wahi for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He used to be the neighbor of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we're going to talk about his life, inshallah, after two or three talks. We're going to start talking about those prominent qurra, something about their lives, inshallah. So the other person was Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Zubayr radiallahu anhu. The third person was Sayyidina Sa'id ibn al-As radiallahu anhu. And the fourth one was Sayyidina Abdul Rahman ibn al-Harith ibn Hisham. Those four people, they were commanded by Sayyidina Uthman radiallahu anhu to do what? What will they do? They will make 6 or 7 copies of the master copy, of the main copy that was with Sayyidina Hafsa radiallahu anha. This is what they're gonna do. They're not gonna invent a new way. They're not gonna add something or delete something. They will do just copying. But you know, when you're copying something, you might make mistakes, right? So they made this committee, and the Sahaba were there, and they started this huge task. But there's a problem that they're gonna face. If you remember in Azerbaijan, the problem was that some of the Muslims from Syria or from Sham, they heard different way of reading the Quran from the people of Iraq and vice versa. So they were surprised. So now we have multiple recitations and we have one copy. So what was the challenge? The challenge is to accommodate all of these multiple recitations in one copy. They want to make one copy. So if we have Maliki Yawmiddin, as we read now in Isha prayer, and we have Maliki Yawmiddin, how are we going to accommodate these two words with their two different readings in one copy? Another example, we have, for example, Nunshizuha and Nunshiruha. These two words, they have different dots. How are they going to accommodate it? This is easy. This is the easy part. But the difficult part was, if there is a reading that has an extra word than the other reading. Like, for example, in Hafs narration, Ayat al-Tawbah, chapter 9, Ayah 100. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, تجري تحتها الأنهار. تجري تحتها الأنهار. Another قراءة, تجري من تحتها الأنهار. How they're gonna accommodate these two different readings in one copy? Let's start with the easy part. The easy part, which is the differences in the qira'at that is related only to the tashkeel or to the dots. For example, like what I read in Surah Al-Masad, Hammalatul Hatab, right? But in Hafs, how do you read it? Hammalatul Hatab, right? Everyone gave different meaning, but not contradictory meanings. No, multiple readings, and it gives richness in the meaning as we explained earlier. Now, this is already solved. Why? because in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there was no harakat on the letters, no vowels, no fatha, no dhamma, no kasra. So that word is written ham, ha, mim, alif, lam, ta. No harakat at all. The harakat were invented later on, even after the, almost in the time of Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu, as we will mention in the coming talks inshallah. So this type of differences is already solved. Now what about the dots? We have the word, for example, nunshizuha, and we have the word nunshiruha. One word is zai and one word is ra. How they're gonna solve this? It's already solved. Why again? Because there were no dots in that time. So if you look at, yes, just if you Google the old manuscripts of the Quran, the very old ones, you will not find any dots or any harakat. So that type of differences is already accommodated. Now, we have like the word Maliki and Maliki. It was written Meem, Lam, Kaf. Meem, Lam, Kaf. How do you read Meem, Lam, Kaf? Maliki. Later on, they just added a dagger, small alif. If you look at the Mus'haf now, you will not see Meem, long alif, lam, kaf. You will see Meem, lam, kaf. After the Meem, you will see this small dagger alif, right? To accommodate the other readings. So these ones are solved. Now, the difficult one is when we have an extra word. And remember, all of these readings were received and were learned and taught by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Here, they had to do a serious solution to accommodate those readings. And they are not a lot in the whole Quran. They are very, very few. They are very few. For example, we have in Surah Tawbah, تَجْرِي تَحْتَهَا الْأَنْهَارِ. Another example, I read to my shaykh, for example, in Surah Hadid, the qira'ah of Ibn Amir, he says, وَمَنْ يَتَوَلَّ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ الْغَنِيُّ الْحَمِيدِ. Not فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الْغَنِيُّ الْحَمِيدِ. Okay, both meanings, one of them has more emphasis than the other. So how they did that? The only possible scenario is that all of these Sahaba radiallahu anhum and Sayyidina Uthman particularly, he called on those Sahaba who were scattered in the main Muslim cities teaching people the Quran, right? And they know different readings. He brought them. I did not read one of the scholars that he said this, but this is the only possible scenario that we find. The scholars mentioned that they, radiallahu anhum, in some masahif, they put those words, and in some masahif, they did not put them. For example, the mus'haf, how many copies they're gonna make? Almost seven copies, okay? Seven copies. To Al-Madinah, Al-Munawwara, he kept one in Al-Madina and he kept one for himself, radiallahu anhu, Sayyidina Uthman, as they say. So these are two. One for Mecca, Al-Mukarrama, one for Sham, one for Basra, one for Kufa, and one for Yemen. Some say also one for Bahrain. Bahrain, not the current Bahrain, it's the east coast, if you like, of the Gulf. So, of the peninsula. So these copies, for example, in the copy that they sent to Sham, they did not write وَمَنْ يَتَوَلَّ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الْغَنِيُّ الْحَمِيدِ. They just wrote وَمَنْ يَتَوَلَّ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ الْغَنِيُّ الْحَمِيدِ. And where did they send it? To Sham. And the other copies that don't have this, they send it to the other cities. And if we have one of the qira'at from those cities, then they also did not add it there. So they, in some copies they put those words, in some copies they did not. Now, the only possible scenario is that that Sayyidina Uthman brought them. He did not do this by just randomly. He never did this randomly, radiallahu anhu. Absolutely not. Why? Because you cannot randomly, okay, in this coming let's add this word. No, absolutely not. Right? Absolutely impossible that he will just do it randomly. So what he did is he got those sahaba who are skillful in those multiple qira'at. And he himself knew more than one qira'at. And Sayyidina Zayd bin Thabit radiallahu anhu, if you read the chains of the qira'at that we have today, you will find Sayyidina Zayd bin Thabit radiallahu anhu in every qira'at, you will find his name. So he learned many qira'at, Sayyidina Zayd. Sayyidina Ubay bin Ka'ab learned many qira'at. Sayyidina Uthman, many qira'at. Sayyidina Ali, many qira'at. Sayyidina Abdullah bin Mas'ud, more than one qira'at. And the proof is we have now in our chains that link us to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We find them in there in our chains, the salasil, the chains of transmission. So they knew more than one qira'at. Now the only possible scenario is he got all of them and said, okay, who's in Kufa, for example, or who's in Sham? In Sham we have Sayyidina Abu Darda and Sayyidina Ubay. Okay, what is the reading you received from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Abu Darda and Sayyidina Ubay, these two Sahaba, he will tell them, and he knows, guys, this is the narration you received from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Okay, in this position, you did not get it as وَمَنْ يَتَوَلَّ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ, right? You got it وَمَنْ يَتَوَلَّ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ الْغَنِيُّ الْحَمِيدُ. Okay, so in the copy that we're gonna give it to you, with which you will go to Sham and teach people, we will not go to Huwa, because this is the way you received it from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And let's see all of the other ayat. So what he did, radiallahu anhu, every Sahabi or more than one Sahabi who will go to a certain city, he will see the reading they got from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and Sayyidina Zayd already know it, Sayyidina Uthman already know it, so they will give them the copy that suit their narration that they learned from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is the only scenario. And he did, radiallahu anhu. And this is why in the Mus'haf, in those seven Masahif, as the scholars mentioned, they say in the Shami Mus'haf, for example, you don't see Huwa. Why? Because this is how Sayyidina Abu Darda and Sayyidina Ubay received it from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this is how they taught the people of Sham, and they taught the Tabi'een, and from the Tabi'een of the Tabi'een we have Ibn Amir al-Shami. He is one of the Temple Ra. This is how we read it, how he read it. How he reads it like this? He got it from the Sahaba who got it from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and their Mus'haf, the Mus'haf of Sham, agrees with this way. For example, the Mus'haf of Mecca, the scholars mentioned in the Mus'haf, in the Mecki Mus'haf, it is not tajri tahtaha, it is tajri min tahtiha. So those Sahaba who were specialized in the Quran in Mecca, they sat and they consulted with the Sayyidina Uthman and all of the committee, and they found if they needed to add a word according to the narration they received from the Prophet ﷺ, they will add it in the Mus'haf that will be sent to Mecca, and they will teach the Quran according to that way. So by this, they accommodated all of the multiple readings of the Quran, and we know that the dialects, how will people learn the dialects? From the Qurra. How will people know this word is read Musa or Musa? How will they know? Can they know from the writing? Impossible. They will learn it from the Qari. So those differences are already accommodated in that writing. So this shows you, dear brothers and sisters, the amazing and the creative ways through which those great Sahaba radiallahu anhum preserve those multiple recitations of the Quran in two ways, in writing and in the oral transmission. Without a single mistake, without a single deletion or addition in any letter. After the all of the Sahaba agreed on this, those six copies, what did he do, radiallahu anhu? He sent every copy with those skillful qurra, because you cannot again read it just from the Mus'haf, right? People will not know, oh, this is Duha or Duha, this is Imran or Imrain. How will they know? You cannot read it by yourself, you have to read it from the Qari. But those Masahib, those master copies, they are references. When people want to make copies, where will they make copies from? From those particular copies. It was not allowed to make copy from any other copy. So he, radiallahu anhu, standardized the Mus'haf and made these copies, and he commanded anyone who had any different copy of the Quran, whether it is one surah or the whole Quran, he commanded it to be burned. Who? Sayyidina Uthman, radiallahu anhu. By himself or with the agreement of the Sahaba? They did not have dictatorship. Alhamdulillah. They did not have dictatorship. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, وَأَمْرُهُمْ شُورَى بَيْنَهُمْ. Their affairs are conducted by consultation and mutual consultation. No one would say, no, no, I'm gonna do this, you have to obey. No. So all of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, by consensus, and imagine there are hundreds and thousands of Sahaba, all of them agreed to those six copies, from which we received the copies that we have. And we will continue the link until I mention, inshallah, how we have this copy with the dots and with the harakat, etc. So they, radiallahu anhum, agreed to burn those masahib, and they did. And all of them collaborated, even though it is very, very difficult. Imagine you have a copy and you were writing the notes from who? From who they were writing the notes? From the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And in their masahib, they used to write some tafsir on the margin, some explanation, some ahadith they hear from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So imagine those precious copies that they had. How difficult it is to burn that copy and to give it up. It's so difficult. To the extent Sayyidina Abdullah bin Mas'ud radiyallahu anhu, in the beginning, he rejected. He said, what? How you want me to burn the copy of the Quran that I wrote, and I wrote tafsir, and I wrote commentary? I heard it from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imagine. It's a very, very precious thing. If I lose the notebook that I used to take in my Sheikh's lectures, it will be very painful to me. So what about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Those notes, they took it from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So in the beginning, he rejected to burn his Mus'haf. Then the Sahaba convinced him.
يَا حَافِظَ الْقُرْآنِ رَتِّلْ آيَهِ فَالْكُلُّ أَنْصَتَ لِلتِّلَاوَةِ مُطْرِقًا يَا حَافِظَ الْقُرْآنِ لَسْتَ بِحَافِظٍ حَتَّى تَكُونَ لِمَا حَفِظْتَ مُطَبِّقًا مَاذَا يُفِيدُكَ أَنْ تُسَمَّى حَافِظًا وَكِتَابُ رَبِّكَ فِي الْفُؤَادِ تَمَزَّقًا
يَا أُمَّتِي الْقُرْآنُ حَبْلُ نَجَاتِنَا فَتَمَسَّكِي بِعُرَاهُ كَيْ لَا نَغْرَقَا وَلْتَجْمَعِي حول الكتاب شتاتنا حتى نزيل تناحرا وتفرقا ولتجعلي محكما في أمرنا وثقي بوعد الله أن يتحققا يا أمتي القرآن حبل نجاتنا فتمسكي بعراه كي لا